Our guest today is an extraordinary personality. He is a first generation techno entrepreneur with an exemplary record of achievements. An alumnus of the Harvard Business School, he is the first ever Indian to be decorated with the prestigious George Washington Carver 2020 Award by the BioImpact Washington of the USA. He also holds the Distinguished Alumnus Award and the Distinguished Service Award by the IIT Mumbai and the Empresario Most Inspiring Entrepreneur Award by NITI of Mumbai. Voted amongst the globally top 100 people in bioenergy space by Biofuels Digest, not once, but for consecutively 3 years in a row, he carries the BioSpectrum Leadership Award for his remarkable work in promoting the cause of biofuels. Our distinguished guest is also associated with many prestigious organizations, and he holds responsible positions in all of these. I'm going to have to use the paper so that I don't miss out on any credentials. He is the president of Advisory Council of Board for the Savitri Bai Phule Pune University. He is the member of the CII National Council for 2021 and mentor of the CII Task Force of Bioenergy. He is the founder, member and president of the Indian Federation of Green Energy. He is the member of Board of Governors of the Government College of Engineering, COEP of Pune, and a prestigious NITI, and also the Council of Past Presidents of the MCCI of Pune. I think this introduction is more than sufficient to guess who our esteemed guest today is. Let me cordially and warmly invite Dr. Pramod Chaudhary to the couch today.
Namaskar.
His remarkable work over the years, his incessant commitment towards the cause of promoting biofuels has been a hallmark in the Indian scientific community. So without taking much more time, let us shift the spotlight to Dr. Chaudhary and let us hear what he has to say on the subject. Welcome, Dr. Chaudhary. A few words.
Namaskar. Oh, you're given a very long list. I think it's not really very important. What is the most important part is about the progress which Praj could achieve in the last 35-year span in the area of industrial biotechnology space. And I will be very happy to talk, discuss about it, and also learn in the process. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
So, welcome again, sir. I'm going to take you a little back in timeline, about 24 or 25 years back when we started with TED, the Technological Engineering Division, in a small unit in Bhosri. And that has converted into a sprawling, state-of-the-art, world-class R&D facility, which we call the Matrix now, located near Pune. So the journey to this juncture today must not be without challenges. But what we've observed is your investment in every manner of speaking, you know, money, machine, manpower, material, all this was always steadily there. It was, you know, it was a constant support for the research and development activity. Now, I want to know if this was out of passion or a drive for this kind of work, or was it a businessman's calculated risk? Can you share if, you know, your vision for Praj actually evolved or metamorphosed with the changing need of the times?
Since you say we go back and try to find out the genesis of the R&D or innovation approach of Praj, so let me start in the beginning. I'm basically a mechanical engineer and not a biotechnologist. So always I was looking towards biotechnology, chemical sciences from outside in, and that always created some kind of a curiosity. What I realized in the early stages is the biotechnology related processes are dealing with the live organisms, mm-hmm. and they behave in a very erratic manner, if you allow me to say that. And to tame them and to get the desired activity from their working is, I think, is a very challenging task. And to achieve that part, I thought I must have a proper backup that we can test and we can tame and they can work them with a consistent performance. Along with that, because we are working on molasses as a starting feedstock, which is the worst kind of a feedstock, with all contamination, lot of muck inside it. So that creates the problem or multiplies the problem. So to look into this and to go develop insight for molasses, those sugars which we are converting for value added product, that was the reason why we started with a small R&D setup way back in 89-90 actually. It was basically not a research and development, it was more to do with the applied research. It was more to do application engineering. How do we adopt the various feedstocks or what kind of a thing is required, what parameters to be arrived at? That was the basic limited purpose. So that's where the, when you talk about TED or Technology Engineering Department, was really running during the year mid-90s, which was engaged into applied research. And there's no something what we called as a basic research. But we deployed, we didn't spare on the resources, good talented manpower, machinery, equipment, in whatever manner we could afford at that point of time was going on. The next development happened in the journey on the R&D side is towards the end of 90s, when the winds of biofuels, use of alcohol as ethanol into petrol, started catching up eye all over the world. And I soon realized that this is going to come to India. In India, somewhere in 1999-2000, it became important when the Bajpayee government took cognizance of this as a prospective biofuel to be used along with petrol. And that was a major turning point. Mm-hmm. And maybe whatever it is that businessmen's, with modestly I would use the word acumen, I got myself prepared Praj for dehydration of alcohol to convert into ethanol. So the dehydration is a major step for alcohol. And that again became one of the important milestones for Praj to enter into ethanol field. And that entire development of technology, again this R&D approach helped me. And that's how we had a bigger R&D shifted in Baudhan. So what you refer earlier was in Bhosri, it got shifted to Baudhan in 2002. Dr. Mashelkar was personally there to inaugurate that. And that's how we started a next level of R&D at our Praj house in Baudhan. Next point came because of this ethanol blending initiative of Bajpayee government. And they rightly named it as a Swadeshi Intan. Unfortunately, 2004, the government changed. But what efforts we had put in, we could direct our efforts to other developing countries, namely South America. Colombia was the one country, Thailand was the other country, Thailand and Philippines. And that's where again this R&D approach played a role to making our process technology robust to local requirements. And that gave us a chance to look at the tropical belt as really our karmabhumi to introduce biofuels. So our Colombian experience had two important fallouts. One is our next target was to look at Europe and USA. And there with that experience, we could really make a good impact. Since you belong to or you studied there, I must tell you that UK's first biofuel plant is based on our technology. And that was a matter of pride for all projects. It was in Yorkshire, but later on there was one more project which we put up, the largest project in Europe in Hull site. Yeah, that was 1.2 million liters per day. So that became another thing. It was a joint with British Petroleum and British Sugar and DuPont. So that became another feather in cap. Meanwhile, we did that work in Germany, in Belgium. So practically all development, because so far people are thinking, oh, we are doing only for the developing country. No, with UK, Germany, Belgium doing those projects, that became a matter of really that we are able to meet those requirements. So that was another milestone. And best part of that, in Praj, most of our employees, I was very particular that we select the people from vernacular background. that drew an attention of a gentleman evangelist called Vinod Khosla. I don't know whether you heard his name. He was the founder of Sun Microsystems. And he, after selling Sun, he became a venture capitalist supporting only green technologies. So he heard the name of Prash. So one day he called me from USA and wanted to know more about me. And then it was a call set for only 15 minutes, but we continued talking for more than an hour. I was asking my, sharing my idea, what way we can do and all that. So he says, later on we met, I went to meet him in Kellogg School of, he was in the Kellogg School of Management, he was on the governing body of Kellogg. So he was just commenting that we Indians, we only do applied research, we don't do basic research. So he said, you should look at that. I said, I can do it, but it requires a lot of funds. So he said, I'll give you funds. So that was a major milestone in the history of Praj, that this journey with Colombia, Europe and other places put together gave us a good confidence, response and kind of a recognition.
Sir, you rightly mentioned, you know, that during Vajpayee's reign, we used the word Swadeshi. So that is what we knew. But now this sentiment has evolved into what we called as Atmanirbhar. So that is the key word for today. How do you think this basic research, this classical research which is going on at Matrix in biotechnology will actually help us and take us towards self-sufficiency or Atmanirbharta?
We know that India is importing 80% crude oil, and crude oil is a main drain on our foreign exchange dependence on Middle East and so many other countries. So this government, rightly so, decided to give push to biofuels, which was once upon a time called Swadeshi Indan, and make more and more use so that the crude oil dependence will come down. So that is point number one. Secondly, this is a homegrown feedstock, raw material, so that the money gets circulated like a circular economy within the country. Like farmers get benefited. Instead of the sheikhs of Middle East, it is the Indian farmers who will get benefit out of this self-reliance. Atmanirbhar is nothing but the self-reliance, that you don't have to depend for your fuels. The second aspect is getting the security, that you are secure that your energy is coming from internal sources and not again from the sources which are outside your control. So that self-reliance, and all this is done with the help of local technology, homegrown technology. So if you look at the three things, the feedstock is local, domestic, the technologies are local, and the product is going for the local consumption. So this value chain, I think, is a very important aspect of this Atmanirbharta. And that's why we proudly say that, okay, this was coined maybe off late, maybe 2 years back or 3 years back. But this is being the hallmark or the ethos of our working in this area. The other part is also there, that governments, so many programs are now becoming compatible with the way we are trying to do. The other aspect is on sustainability. Shashwat Vikas, that is another important area, that this ensures that we are able to fight the threats of climate change. And I think that is also equally important, that this entire value chain of going for bioenergy is helping to establish Shashwat Vikas or sustainability. The third aspect, which is another angle, is that it is benefiting the average laborer or a small farmer, because they are the part of this value chain. And the concept which is being launched, or which is considered as Antyodaya, is also ultimately is helping that the money which is coming by replacing the oil and gets circulated in the local economy to the last link into the whole thing. That's the way we look at it, because those are the, and we are also looking at development of small farmers, small entrepreneurs, entire thing contributing to this whole value chain. Last but not the least, one which we are going to try now is you produce and consume there. That will be another angle of life cycle analysis, that you don't create carbon footprint. See, in normal case, the ethanol which is produced in the rural, well, ethanol is generally produced from the farm goods, so it is produced, farm produce, it is going into the rural area, then you take it to the refinery which is away, and then again bring back the blended petroleum. So it is a too many of carbon footprint. So what we try to say, that we will try to develop a consumption pattern for ethanol at the point of generation. So that will really save a lot of footprints, carbon footprints. So these are the ways and means, and then all those taxation, all those things can be also perhaps can be given concession that they can do it locally, everything. So this is a little bigger picture, and it is also possible. See, unlike the oil refinery, which is a economic is established only with the size, bigger is the profitable, bigger is the more important, bigger capacity. Here in our case, we talk about a smaller capacities, and smaller capacities decentralized, so they can give you the development of a regional development can happen. So these are the aspects of doing this in a rural areas. So from starting with Swadeshi Indan way back in 2000, which you may refer again, to Atmanirbhar in this end of this decade, 20s, I think the journey clearly shows that this shift is definitely beneficial to the country, to the different strata of the society, for the environment, so all three angles. In fact, that is the hallmark of sustainability, that people, planet and profit, all three things happen. 3P is the theme which is happening with the help of this approach. And I am happy that Praj is able to contribute for this journey. In the last 4-5 years, we have seen that current government has given a lot of push to this kind of approach. In fact, the first thing happened, this entire bioenergy subject was placed with MOPNG. I think that was the most important strategic move of this government, because it has become their baby to see that they are able to introduce biofuels in the system. It is not imposed on them. And they are practically managing the oil marketing companies like big corporates. So both put together, I think it was a really a masterstroke. That administrative ministry taking initiative to, and that's why you see that 2016 they had the first biofuel day in India. 2018 they declared the biofuel policy covering both liquid biofuels, gaseous biofuel. And in last 2 years, if you see, there are a number of things are being developed into this. That has prompted us to rise to this occasion and what we call as a biomobility, as a concept, which is our own generation of a concept, biomobility, which takes care of almost 7 types of biofuels to start just now. First generation, second generation from biomass, compressed biogas, which is the gaseous biofuel, then we have biodiesel, now we are working on biomethanol, aviation fuel and marine fuel. So practically the entire gamut is being covered in this area. I think perhaps in the whole world we'll be the only company looking with this, all the angles. And we also will gradually go and take up the what is called as the biohydrogen, bio-based hydrogen and bio-based fuel cells. Because in our strong opinion, we may be a little strong, that EV run on a thermal power plant electricity is not a environment friendly. See, the EV is being talked about. We have a debate on many forums because we feel that EV either is run on a solar energy, fine, it is totally green. But EV, which is getting charged with the power coming from Korodi or those kind of a thermal power plant, that you are creating, you're shifting the urban pollution to the rural pollution. Same kind of carbon is being emitted by these thermal plants. So it has to be totally neutral to this kind of situation. So we feel that we will go with a biofuel cells or some kind of a biohydrogen, which can perhaps help achieve this. But that's for the future. But today these seven fuels we identified, and I am sure that this journey will continue with the same, because we are quite charged and inspired by the policies of the current government.
You were mentioning value cycle, so I want to extrapolate on that thought. Praj offers technological solutions, but that is like just one piece of the jigsaw puzzle. There may be other factions who are also contributing to the success of the entire project. How do you think our agri sector is in tandem with all this? Do you think they are really prepared or equipped to, you know, take that next step towards real Atmanirbharta that we are talking of now?
There are two value chains. To answer your question, there are two value chains. One is our business cycle value chain, where we say it is the incoming feedstock, processing with the help of technological solution, engineering as the engineering design, equipment manufacture, and project management. So this become one value chain. And Praj is offering end-to-end solution every year. So that unless it is integrated properly, the customer or the project owner won't get benefited fully. So this is one approach. The second approach is that feedstock. What is the feedstock? Feedstock is nothing but agri product, either agri residue or agri product. So in this area, if farmer has to be an integral part of this value chain. Now today, if you look at this problem which is happening in Punjab and Haryana of stubble burning, there the farmer has to be educated, and farmer has to show that instead of burning, if it is collected, aggregated and sent to the biorefinery, he will get extra value for his stubble, otherwise which is going zero. So this is how you have to link in the farmers. The other aspect is that, see, this we are definitely not dominated by sugarcane crops, because the sugarcane grows with but guzzles a lot of water. One side we feel it's a lazy crop, because you don't have to keep on looking after it. But at the same time, these are the things, it's the 8-10 month cycle. So we are looking at alternate crops, and we have done a lot of work in that area. Actually, this work which we had done in early decade, in this century, early decade, was mainly in the area of sweet sorghum. Now, sweet sorghum, or called kadwal in local language, is a kind of a jowar, but not the same thing. Its stalk holds a lot of sugary juice, and that cannot be converted into a table sugar, but it can be used for making ethanol. The best part is that it is a 4-month crop. So we can take more than 2 crops in a year. So same piece of land, you can create higher output.
Shorter cycle.
Yeah, shorter cycle. So you can, so I consider this as a concept which is that per square meter of land, because land is a limited resource, you can't just keep on creating, that should produce maximum alcohol in a year. We got year as a measurement. So in case of sugarcane, suppose 1 square meter is producing say 50 liters of alcohol per year, sweet sorghum with two and a half cycles can produce 75 to 80 liters in a year, taking less water. Only thing is that because of this frequent harvesting, that what I said earlier, that farmers have to be a little alert. Tatas came forward. That is how I got introduced to Tatas, that they put up a plant in Nanded area, ethanol distillery based on sweet sorghum. It was first of its kind. We had designed the complete project. We had given inputs for this thing. But farmer psyche, we could not influence. Mm-hmm. But then we realized that dealing with farming community is a different ball game. To answer your question, efforts are there to rope them in.
Mm-hmm.
But to make them have a sustained interest and their education or their awareness. I also tried a hand of, at Praj to have growing under ideal condition.
We know that Dr. Chaudhary has a nickname, Mr. Ethanol. So I think that in a way speaks of his very deep involvement in his business and the overall journey of Praj. Sir, no business is without challenges, without pitfalls, and you know, without crisis. Taking it from Mr. Ethanol, I wanted to know a little about your personal journey in this entire Praj story. You must have come to crossroads, you know, many times. You must have been in dilemmas. Now, obviously, now we know that you've taken the road less traveled. But, you know, for all the youth of, you know, the youth generation, I just wanted to know what drove you to take that road less travel, or, you know, how did you evaluate your options, and what helped you to take the right road?
It's a mixture of so many things. There's no one comment covering all the aspects. But I can say that first time or couple of times I touched the bottom and came back. So, business adventures, yes. Like in the early stages, to establish ourselves, we had to take a contract with entire payment subject to final approval by the client. So that was the starting point. It was a very big blunder which I did. I won't do it now, but that time I did it because I was very keen to get an entry into this thing. We came to some extent but did not come fully, so I had to look for funding. I stumbled upon venture capital. So we are the first Indian company, engineering company to get venture capital from ICICI those days. So any difficult situation, challenge getting converted into some kind of opportunity has been the effort. I am a robust optimist. Okay, that's the way I'll put it. One robust optimist, always some positive look, thinking is always there. And I think that helps. So if you want really looking for the message, positive thinking is the solution. You have to be a otherwise, if you throw, and then as a leader, you throw up the towel, the entire chain will, the command will go in that direction. So that is one thing that that optimism has helped me. So practically every 10 years cycle, 10, 11 years, you get some jhatka.
So now it's a formula.
It becomes like a formula. But then, we learn out of this also,
right.
That come 2008-9, when there was a subprime crisis,
mm-hmm.
We were pretty ready to sustain the shock that time.
Okay.
And the simple logic, which I have also mentioned in my book, or I always tell young entrepreneurs, cash is the king. If you don't have the cash in your pocket, the world will not entertain you in this difficult time. So, and I can tell you one thing, for last 17, 18 years, we are totally debt-free company. So this is, again, robust optimism.
So Dr. Chaudhary, there is so much happening on your table each day, you know, and you're so busy in all these different activities. How do you keep or reserve that extra mental bandwidth or keep your motivation and spirits high and still keep up with social activities, social commitments, and also all your various CSR activities like Seva Vardhini and role in academics, and it's truly inspirational.
No, these are subjects of my liking also. It's not that when you like the subject, and every subject ultimately gets connected. So one is on the side of the rural areas where I like to see that their life, quality of life is improved. So that is one area where we are busy, where I am also helping or taking help from Seva Vardhini, done Janakalyan, and so many places we have done water projects, education, a circular economy among the small farmers. This project I must mention about this because we are trying it, very close by, that help them grow vegetables in the backyard by using the wastewater from their own small bathrooms or whatever it is, households. And those vegetables are improving the health of the women in the rural area. That is a very successful, and what small thing we did, we give them iron utensils. Instead of stainless steel, use iron because they are lack of having
hemoglobin.
That is one part. Or in the Adivasi band of Wada Taluka, developing new recipes from the wild vegetables.
Oh.
And by putting a competition among them. And that has been also another very successful thing. These are small, small things, but they do contribute and they spread then. Because it doesn't require very huge amount of money.
Mm-hmm.
But these are the few things which are tried, conceived, tried, tested. And they are becoming now a regular way of life. So this is a kind of a CSR we try to do. I have actually a theory. No, I will go into those details because I was actually carrying, I thought I will look for an opportunity to mention that. The theory, what I call is a 9-box grid. For any country, for any society, any nation, there are three things. Scarcity, then what is the security they want from, and what is the scalability. Now, India, all the three challenges are there. We want security from water, oil, all those things. Scarcity, some of them also in scare. Once upon a time, food was scare. Thing. And third is scale. So many 1.35 billion people and all that. It's a scale, scalability. So all this, what Nandan could achieve with the help of the scalability challenges. This. And we have moved. So these are the three challenges. The on other side, we have to maintain sustainability. Because you can't do addressing these challenges by allowing the sustainability to suffer. So what is the sustainability? You have to take care of the people, society. There should not be too much disparity. You have to take care of environment, that you don't erode the environment to make a progress. And third is, there has to be a reasonable economical equivalence. So these, if you see in the 9-box, these are the three boxes of challenges, these are the three reference points which you have to maintain. So in the middle column, there are three things which are playing a very important role as a solution to this matrix. And one is education. The second one is innovation.
Mm-hmm.
And third one is entrepreneurship. So that's the way I look this as a solution.
This is a mantra for the youth of tomorrow.
Not youth, youth for the nation, for everything actually. I think you are the right people to take it forward.
So, thanks so much for coming on the couch with us, talking heart to heart and sharing all your stories. I'm sure a lot of people are going to take very positive messages, vibes, inspiration from your story, and we'll hope to keep receiving your mentorship in the future, sir.
I hope so. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, sir.